The TARDIS has landed in a misty swamp. The ground is rocky and pitted with small bubbling pools, which occasionally spray a fine silver mist into the air. The Doctor wanders away, still fascinated by the contents of the diary. Strolling directly towards a small pool of mercury, he is apparently oblivious to any danger, yet manages to successfully circumnavigate the obstacle without once looking up from his reading. Suddenly realizing what he's done, he stops and looks back, delighted at having outwitted the obstruction. But then he looks down and sloshes out of the watery puddle in which he is now standing.
Are you coming, you two?
The Doctor continues on his way. After a short distance, he stops once more. A boulder blocks his path. Pulling a tape measure from his pocket, he takes some extensive measurements of the rock and scribbles some calculations on an empty page of the diary. The Doctor glances round him. The boulder stands in a clearing, and he could easily walk round it, but a look of mischief crosses his face. Backing up a few steps, the Doctor looks down at his legs, flexing his knees.
I might put you through some tests, I think.
Breaking into a run, the Doctor successfully leapfrogs the boulder.
Hello!
A newcomer has entered the clearing.
Hello! Is there anyone there? Hello! Hello!
Why don't they come?
He catches sight of the Doctor.
Ah, so you've come at last. I'm from Earth. I'm the examiner.
The man crumples to the ground, shot. Horrified, the Doctor's about to dive for cover when the thought occurs to him that the man might still be alive. He pauses and glances back at the cover of the rocks before, keeping his head low and looking warily about him, he approaches the fallen figure. Turning the body over, he sees that it's too late. The man must indeed have died instantly. Searching for some kind of identification, the Doctor finds a large round badge. Automatically reaching into his top pocket, he pulls out a pair of wire-rimmed spectacles and puts them on. He squints at the badge and moves it backwards and forwards, trying to focus on it. Yet all he can see is a misty blur. He removes the spectacles and tries again. This time the text is clear. Realizing that he no longer needs glasses, the Doctor returns them to his pocket, then reads aloud from the identity badge.
Earth Examiner. Accord every access. Vulcan.
Behind the Doctor, a figure looms out of the mist. Wearing an all-concealing white suit and goggles, the figure trains a pistol on the Doctor's back.
Doctor, where are you?
The Doctor turns at the sound of Ben's voice. The figure dodges out of sight. Close to the TARDIS, Ben and Polly are exploring the swamp.
Whoa, and it's hot.
Do you think the air's like this everywhere?
Nah, it might be just around here. I want too many lungfuls of it, I know that. Here, when I was a kid, we used to live off a brewery. You could take a walk and get tipsy all in one go.
It's beautiful.
Oh, don't touch it, Polly.
I wasn't going to.
Nah, it's quicksilver, it gets through the pores. Where is that Doctor or whatever he is got to?
As Ben moves away, a cloud of mercury vapour catches Polly full in the face.
What's the matter? Hey, Polly! Hey, Doctor, wherever you are, quick, there's something after Polly!
The Doctor heads back to the TARDIS at a run.
We're going this way!
Pistol raised as a bludgeon, the suited figure steps out behind the Doctor and knocks him down. The Doctor grabs at the figure briefly before sinking to the ground, unconscious. Working quickly, the stranger presses something into the Doctor's palm, then drags the examiner's body away. The Doctor is left sprawled on the ground, a button clutched in his outstretched hand. Meanwhile, Ben is trying to drag the unconscious Polly to safety. Another cloud of mercury vapour rises from the pool.
Doctor!
The last thing Ben sees before he passes out is a white-suited figure holding a pistol, approaching fast. Sometime later, a young man in a white survival suit, goggles pushed up over his head, is kneeling beside the seemingly unconscious Doctor. Another older man, similarly attired, approaches.
Ah, Ben, there you are. What have you got there? My people have found two more of them by one of the pools.
This one's got a nasty bruise on the back of his head. Fallen over his feet and knocked himself out, I suppose.
I suppose so.
Why don't they use the kit we send them?
Yes. The other two have had a rather bad dose of fumes. And the girl has, anyway.
Girl?
Yes.
but she'll recover.
Ben and Polly are helped into the clearing by two guards.
These comic opera guards of yours do have some uses after all. I picked them for their physical fitness. I thought it wasn't for their IQ. Give me a hand with the examiner, will you?
I wonder why Earth has chosen to send an examiner to Vulcan. Just now, I mean.
I don't know.
It's a mystery, isn't it? He isn't due for another 2 years.
Ben is recovering.
How do you feel? We saw your rocket overshoot the landing area. Don't worry. Most of the ships from Earth do overshoot. I'm Quinn, Deputy Governor.
Reagan, Head of Security.
Let's get them all back, shall we?
I'll take the girl.
Here, you two.
Help carry the examiner.
The guards lift the doctor between them.
I suppose you Earth people can't wait to examine Lesterson's space capsule.
Hi.
Ben is startled as the doctor winks slyly at him. Lesterson, chief scientist of the Vulcan colony, is sitting in his laboratory polishing an oddly shaped piece of metal. A huge space capsule dominates one side of the room. Lesterson's assistant, Janley, joins him.
Lesterson. Look at this.
They just brought in an examiner from Earth and a couple of assistants.
An examiner? What's he here for?
Well, I thought you'd know.
It's the capsule. It must be. Well, they can't stop me working on it, so I'll tell you that.
Could anyone?
The governor's always been difficult about it. Surely they wouldn't send somebody all the way from Earth just...
Look, what about the meeting?
Meeting?
Well, yes, I've arranged everything. Can we still use the old rocket room?
Yes, I suppose so. But I do wish you wouldn't get mixed up with these pressure groups, Janley.
Well, somebody has to do something. The colony's running down and you know it.
Well, I'm too busy.
Well, if we ran things, you'd have better facilities, more money. I wish you'd take an interest.
Now, look, I don't mind letting you have the use of one of my rooms now and again, Janley, but don't try to involve me. This is what I find important. 200 years in a mercury swamp, and this piece of metal that dropped from it. Look, a couple of minutes polishing, and it's as good as new.
One.
Rain, damp, heat, mercury. Nothing touches this metal. No corrosion, Janley. Think of that.
Well, I hope the examiner lets you go on with your experiments. Frankly, I doubt it. I think the governor's brought the examiner here to stop you opening the capsule. You should join our group, Lesterson. You might need us one day.
Janley leaves Lesterson to consider her words.